Hello everyone, and welcome to the Futurum Careers podcast. My name's Joe, and I'll be your host for this episode, which features Dr. Geraldine Balzer from the University of Saskatchewan in Canada. Geraldine is working with teachers to develop alternative teaching methods that can be used to decolonise classrooms and make teaching more open, collaborative, and inclusive. In this conversation, we spoke about some of these alternative methods and how teachers can change the power dynamics in their classrooms. We spoke about the need to teach literature which reflects the diversity of their students. And we spoke about Geraldine's passion for social justice and how that has motivated her to conduct this research. So without further ado, here's Dr. Geraldine Balzer on the Futurum Careers podcast. So Geraldine, your research involves looking at strategies that teachers can use to begin decolonising their classrooms. So could you start briefly by explaining what decolonization is in terms of education and why there's a need for it?
So I think in a context, specifically like Canada, which is a settler colony, but then all of the sort of settler colonies that exist around the globe, there's this incredible diversity in classrooms. And we've had a school structure that was really designed on a Eurocentric system to meet very specific goals. I think current research really starts pulling into thinking about a capitalist economy that worked because of the colonial system, etc. But as our world has become more fluid, our classrooms have become more diverse, and we end up with a system structured on a world that doesn't exist anymore. So we find that many of the students in our classrooms are not represented in the literature chosen. And their backgrounds are often diminished. We have assumptions about what is important knowledge and what isn't. And we don't recognize the vast amount of knowledge that students bring with them. And also just very much a fact that they need to recognize themselves in the classroom, in the literature that's chosen, in the world perspectives that are looked at, in the history that is taught.
Yeah, and so in the article that Futurum's written for you, you mentioned a few methods that teachers can use to begin decolonizing their classrooms. So from different ways of analyzing literature to rearranging classrooms and trying new forms of discussion. So what methods have you found to be particularly useful for this kind of work?
One method is actually decentralizing the power of the teacher so that the teacher becomes one of the learners. So I've seen teachers that have sort of moved the idea of a teacher's desk out of their classroom. They occupy a table space just like any of the students do. They rearrange the classroom so that desks or tables are in circles or people are working in clusters. So they take that sort of hierarchical structure of a classroom out of the space. And then there's a vulnerability for the teachers because they're also learners and they have to admit what they don't know. And I think we've often created these structures where teachers are supposed to know everything and feel as if they are failing if they admit their vulnerabilities. But I remember one of the stories one of my research assistants told of observing in a classroom with one of the teachers who was participating in the study. And the teacher came in and sat in the circle with the students and put her feet up on the table and slammed the book down on the table and said, "I was so angry when I read this story. I just didn't know that I wanted to go on. Did anybody else feel that way?" And the research assistant was going like, "Oh my gosh, I've never seen a teacher do that before, like admit that this book annoyed them, this sort of relaxed pose in the classroom." She said the kind of energy and conversation and discussion that happened in the room because the teacher was expressing her frustration with a novel that the students then also felt free to offer their critiques and their frustrations. And so I think that there's that sense of the teacher showing their vulnerability so that the students can also be vulnerable.
Yeah, because I guess a lot of the time teachers are in the position of being a role model. So the way that they act is likely to influence their students. So having a more open and expressive response to a novel might encourage that from their students as well. So is your research focused mainly on literature and the books that are taught in schools?
So basically, I've been an English language arts teacher. So literature is a really important part of what I do. And I really started thinking about this when I was teaching in Indigenous communities. And we've been looking at the literature that was being offered. And students would say, like, but where's my story? Where are our stories, right? Because the stories all were very much predominantly British and American authors that were generally white men. The idea of the literature curriculum actually came about because it was used in India to train people who were going to be working for the British government and the tea company, etc., how to be proper British gentlemen. And so the literature chosen had a very specific goal. And then it was successful. So it was brought back to the factory towns of England and Scotland. And so we haven't really thought about why we choose the literature we choose. So one of the things that I like to suggest to teachers is that there should be literature in their classroom that represents the diversity of their classroom. Every child should be able to see themselves in a book. And that shouldn't just be a book that tells the traumatic story of a people. So, you know, if it's going to look at African Americans, it can't just be a slave tale with the trauma. There needs to be stories of success and joy. That's one of the things that people talk about now is, you know, books that celebrate Black joy or Indigenous joy or any marginalized group that are sort of the positive stories there as well. So one of the African-American academic, Rudine Sims Bishop, talks about literature being windows, mirrors, and sliding glass doors. And she said one of the things that often happens is that for minority children, the book is always a window into the life of somebody else. And for mainstream children, the book is always a mirror of their own life. And what we need is to have books that are sliding glass doors that enable readers to move between worlds. So I think that's a really important thing in terms of choosing the literature.
Is it as easy as just a teacher deciding that they want to introduce new books or art? Because in the article that Future's written, there's a few barriers that you talk about, you know, the school curriculum and time pressure, resource pressure, and a lack of confidence, I guess, on a teacher's part and validation from the schools. So what can teachers do to actually start implementing these changes?
Yeah, I think that's the biggest, I mean, sometimes the teacher is the biggest barrier themselves, right? Having the confidence to do that. I think currently within the Canadian structure, we're really being encouraged to include Indigenous voices and Indigenous ways of knowing. And teachers are really, you know, they don't want to move into a world of cultural appropriation. They don't feel competent to answer many of these questions. So that's a space where teachers really need to admit their shortcomings and that they are learners alongside. And sometimes rely on community, the resources available to them in community, and to take those risks and to take small steps. Another barrier is access to resources, because often schools don't see the need to replace literature texts, and that is really a space where teachers need to advocate and sell, you know, sell the reason that they want to use a text to the people who have the power to purchase it. And that's also sometimes one of the pushbacks from parents, is that this isn't, they're not used to their children coming home from school and asking these kinds of questions, or having ideas that are very different from sort of the family structure, and then thinking about how to explain to parents why you've chosen a specific book. So I think that's one of the key things that when I'm working with teacher candidates, you always need to be able to explain why you've chosen the book you're doing, how it meets curricular goals, so that administrators and parents understand that you have a plan for using this.
Yeah, so I guess it's about having the confidence to be able to explain to parents that you're not just doing this as some sort of tick box exercise, you know, ticking the diversity box, but that there are real benefits to your students and all of your students in studying a wider variety of texts. So I'm interested now in what motivates you and what inspired you to do this work in the first place.
I think social justice issues have always been a really key part of who I was. That comes from growing up during an era of civil rights movements and all of those things. So those were the things that were on the news, and they were being made aware. And then living in a faith community that looked to making the world a better place by ensuring that people had resources and access to education. And then also just being the granddaughter of refugees. So, you know, many strands that just continued to weave together till I ended up where I am now. So the liberty that I've had to shape my teaching to those ends, and a shifting curriculum that has the space for teachers to push boundaries as well.
Yeah. Yeah, I get the sense that, maybe you can tell me if this is right, your driving force is sort of a compassion for other people and trying to help other people get the things that they need, get the education that they need.
Yeah, I'd say that's a really big part of it, right? Is that access to education and an education that validates who they are, right? Doesn't just reshape everybody into what some people may have seen as being the ideal citizen, right? That we now embrace the diversity as opposed to trying to make everyone fit into the same mold.
Yeah, amazing. Well, I'm conscious of time, so I've got three more quickfire questions to ask you, just to sort of get to know your personality a bit more. So the first one is, what's your favorite way to spend a Sunday afternoon?
Oh, my favorite way to spend a Sunday afternoon? Either reading books or quilting.
Nice. And the second one is, do you believe in souls?
I do. Yes.
Nice. And the third one is, if you could be any animal in the world, what animal would you be and why?
I am a dog person. I have one sleeping on my feet right at the moment. And I think I would be a dog because of the intimate relationships that they have with human beings and the way in which they are expressive and interactive and have fun in the world.
Great. Well, I've got everything I need, I think, unless there's anything else you want to add.
No, I think that is good. Thank you for this.
No, thank you very much for coming on. It's been great. Think we've got more than enough, and I'm going to have to cut this down into 15 minutes somehow because it was all super interesting.
Okay. Right, there you go.
Well, there we go. That was Dr. Geraldine Balzer on the Futurum Careers podcast. I found that conversation fascinating, and I think that all of us can learn from what Geraldine had to say, whether we're teachers, students, or anyone else. Geraldine was open and articulate, and she's given me lots to think about, so thanks again, Geraldine. If you want to find out more about Geraldine and her research, you can head over to the Futurum Careers website, where you can read her article if you haven't done so already. If you have any questions or comments about anything that we spoke about on this podcast, please feel free to get in touch with us on our social media platforms. You can find us on Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn. Just search for Futurum Careers, and we'd love to hear from you. Well, that's all for now, and I'll be with you again very shortly on the next episode of the Futurum Careers podcast.